friends. In this little demonstration, I'm going to be painting a little 10 by 12 inch canvas of a cheetah that I photographed in the Masai Mara a couple of years ago. Just a bog standard canvas. I've stretched stretcher bars. This is linen, but you could use cotton, doesn't really matter. Obviously, you can buy a ready prepared canvas, it doesn't have to be homemade. I make all my own myself. You could use a panel, but if you use a canvas panel, I suggest you put some gesso on the surface before you paint, because it can be quite a rough texture on some of the panels. But this is a straightforward linen, and I put some one coat of gesso on before I put the coloured ground. This is just, I think this was cadmium red and burnt umber, this colour, but it doesn't really matter. You can either use a ground colour or not, it's up to you. I've also gridded up the surface, I don't know if you can see that, with pencil. I've just gridded up a 2-inch grid just to for the drawing. So I'm just going to take you through the whole process. So let's make a start. Before I start, just thought I'd show you what I'm using. It's not really that critical, but that's ultramarine blue, burnt umber, cadmium orange, cadmium red, cadmium yellow light, and cadmium yellow at the end there. I'm also, for this demonstration, going to use Winsor & Newton liquin, which I've just got a blob of it there, as it'll just help speed the process up. It's a fast drying medium, which it gives a kind of nice luster finish as well. So you don't have to use that. I sometimes use just a mixture of linseed oil and terps. So whatever you prefer. I'm also going to use, just for the drawing, a basic any small point. I don't know what size this is. One, I think, just a small sable type brush. But I'll come on to that. I'll tell you what sort of brushes I'm using later. And I'm using Photoshop for my image, with a grid that I've dropped over the top. And I'll talk to you more about that later. But the main part of this painting is the sunlight. I don't know if you can see it there, but there's some really nice sunlight and cool shadow on the right hand side. And that's the main thing I'm going to be concentrating on. This is just a loose drawing, and has to be reasonably accurate, but wouldn't fuss too much, because later on it'll be refined bit by bit as we go on. So this is just a little, I think it's a number one round brush, but you can use anything you like, really. I'm just marking the main areas. This is the fun part. It's supposed to be the fun part. The best bits of a painting for me are the beginning, which is the bit I'm doing now, and the last closing stages, where it sort of pops into life. Sometimes they can drag a little bit in the middle. It's very strange doing a video recording. I've never actually done this before. I've painted before, but I've never actually recorded it on video, and it feels a little bit different, so bear with me. Start singing to myself. This is a cheetah from the Masai Mara a couple of years ago. There were actually two males at the time, and they were searching, they were wandering around in the evening looking for each other, apparently. And they were brothers, I found out later. And this is one of them, and he just sat on a little termite. You can't see it in this picture, but he's actually sitting on a termite mound, and with the lovely evening sunlight, It was a real spectacle, and he sat right next to us, right next to our safari vehicle. The main exercise that we're doing with this is the sunlight, and there's a nice shadow. You can't see the reference photo at the moment, but there's a nice shadow just at the base of him, which will emphasise the sun. I'm just dipping my brush into the liquid and just using burnt umber at the moment. And around here at the back is a nice cool blue, which we're not putting in at the moment, but I will be later. And I take very careful note of those warm and cold colours working together. Don't spend hours trying to get every little spot and whisker in exactly the right place. That really isn't what it's about. You have a fair bit of freedom. I have been painting these cats for about 30 years, so I'm fairly used to the technique. But if you're just beginning, try to keep it fairly loose and don't get too screwed up about every little spot and its position. Oh, this is shadow, this area on the right here. That's all quite cold shadow. There, I'm using liquin as my main medium. That's, I've just put a blob on the palette, and it helps. It just speeds drying, and it's got a nice consistency to it. But you don't have to use liquin. You can use anything you like. Just standard terps and linseed oil, or anything else. One thing I do want to mention is the colours I use. I always use colours with a single pigment. I'm just going to point this out. Look on the tube. See PR108, that's pigment red 108, which means it's just one single pigment. And in my ultramarine blue, pigment blue 29, a single colour. Some paints have a mixture of different pigments, and they're not quite so, they won't be as vibrant and clean when mixed together. That's just my personal preference, but it's just something I wanted to point out. Right, I've got the main sketch done, so I'm just going to mix a rough, everything's rough, isn't it? I'm just going to mix a shadow colour, a bit of white there, which is a kind of neutralised orange. I'm just going to make a dull orange with a little bit of ultramarine blue, just to kill the intensity of the orange light. So it's a bit of a yucky colour, but that's the sort of thing that I'm going to use for the shadow areas, or part of the shadow areas. It will vary as we go along, but that will do as a starting point. That kind of a little bit of yellow there just to warm it up a bit, and see how we get on and see what it looks like. We can always change it later. Right, with that shadow I've just mixed as a predominantly deep tone up at the top, and it gets to sort of, it moves to white. Down here is kind of lighter fur in sort of nice cool shadow with a fair bit of blue in it, which is reflecting from the sky. It's very hard to actually do this and talk at the same time, so as you can see, it's still as rough as rats, really. There's nothing refined about it. I'm just bunging in the main, blocking in the main areas. come back to that in a minute because that's quite cool. Cool blue. A little bit of shadow under there. On the top of the head there. A little bit of cobalt. A little bit of cool shadow up there, so I'm just going to sling a bit of blue in. It'll all be refined later. Nothing, at no stage do you have to feel it's the end result. It's a process, it's built up with layers. And so don't worry about it looking strange. There's a nice, you can't see it on the photo at the moment, there's a nice cool white just under the chin there. So I've just put one slab of blue on. Most of this animal is in sunlight, so I'm just going to sling a bit of cobalt blue around here because this is quite a nice cool shadow area, and this is one of the main features of the painting actually, which will help to give a sense of sunlight when we finish. This is coming out a little bit muddier than it would, than I would normally have, but because you're making me nervous. And even though it might look a mess at the moment, I promise you it won't at the end.
Well,
it might do, but the plan is that it doesn't. Now there's a nice deep shadow along the base. Again, it's the same sort of burnt umber, cadmium orange, and a little bit of cadmium yellow, just to make a deeper tone of the of this area, which will be a sort of warm ochre kind of colour. Right, I'm just going to mix a little bit of the background colour, just so I can judge better the light on the cheetah's head against the background, because there's a lot of warm sunlight flying around, and the background. I just want to put a bit of the background colour in just so I can judge the two together. A bit of liquid. This is Windsor Green, a thalassinin green, which is a very, very strong pigment. But I'm just going to, that's cadmium yellow and the green, which is very bright green, but we can just reduce the intensity by adding a little bit of cadmium red. And if you're mixing any colour and it's too intense, just look at the colour wheel and mix a little bit of whatever is opposite. In this case it's red, it's complementary colour. So if you were trying to reduce a blue, for instance, you could add a little bit of orange to it and so on. I'm using, size 7 hog brush. I'm just going to put that warm green at the top very roughly. Again, there's nothing refined at this stage. In fact, the background won't be refined at all, even when it's finished. It'll look refined, but it won't be. It'll be painted quite loose. Judge a bit better the colours on the face. And just slab it on. And don't worry, don't smooth it out, because the marks that the brush makes helps later on. You can build up layers of texture which give it a nice attractive look at the end. Right, just going to add a little bit of these warm colours. It's still very, very loose. None of this is refined, because the critical part that I'm doing at the moment is the sunlight. That's really all I'm interested in. And once I've established the lights and the shadows, I can then start to refine it. I never really know what colour a cheetah is officially. They seem to vary. Mainly it's a sort of pale ochre kind of colour, a warm, softly warm yellow. But of course it will depend on the light that they are in at the time. Again, no refinement, just one slab of colour, or tone I should say. And in these lighter areas, when you're painting warm sunlight, that might look, I'm just going to move the camera so I can show you what I'm talking about. If you look at the nose, the area around the nose, it's kind of white, you might say it's white fur, but it's really important to add yellow, cadmium yellow to the paint. So you're actually putting on a very pale yellow or orange, and it will make it, it will give the impression of warm sunlight when it's finished. In theory. I don't know if you can see it, but there's the warm tones against these cold blues are starting to work, even at this early stage. It still looks as rough as rats, but it won't. Have faith. It's almost like an impressionist painting at this stage. There's no detail, absolutely no detail whatsoever. It's all very, very loose. And the detail will come later. At the moment, all I'm interested in is tones and lights, lights and shadows. Right. Now, this shadow here and the contrasting sunlight just above it. By the time I've put this in, just go loosely around my spots. We should get the effect of sunlight. Some lighter fur there, just catching the sunlight at the bottom, just under his chin. Which is rather nice. And there's a lovely shadow falling across the eye here. Which again emphasizes this. Yeah, sunlight. Most of the initial blocking done. So that's the main, that's the first stage more or less complete. I've just blocked in the main areas. There's a reference. Just do a quick comparison. But if I'm going to zoom in now and you'll see how unrefined it is. There's nothing, absolutely no detail whatsoever. It's very, very roughly blocked in. And but at the next stage we will start to refine it, and it will start to take shape. Well, that's the first stage finished, and even though it looks rough at the moment, it won't do, I hope, by the time it's finished, because it will be, as I say, it'll be a series of layers and like a construction process where each layer will be more and more refined as we go along. So the main thing at the beginning is to get the tones and the light, and then you can refine it after that. Right, this is the next day. The paint is dry, and today I'm going to refine some of the darker details on the animal, on the cat, such as the fur there, some of the details around the face, and we're just going to be gently refining some of the blocking that I did yesterday. I'm also just going to show you my paints that I use. Colours that you use are entirely up to you, but just for the record, I use this is a French ultramarine, a green blue, which is Windsor blue or thalassinine blue, pure cadmium red, a violet red, which is rose in this case, but similar to crimson, cadmium yellow, again single pigment, cadmium yellow light, although this is actually lemon, I believe. The colour index on that tells me it's a lemon yellow. Cadmium orange I use sometimes if the reds and my yellows don't give me a bright enough orange. And for my earth colours, Van Dyck brown or burnt umber, and sometimes raw sienna, which is also a single pigment. Right, I'm just going to start refining the area around the eyes and various other places. This is a mixture of Windsor green and crimson to give it a deep, a warm dark, but without being dull. I very rarely use these two colours together, but they give a nice deep black. It's a case really of just breaking up, starting to add texture and breaking up those slabs of colour that I put on yesterday. And my brush now is going to start darting all around the canvas. I don't try to finish any one part all in one go. It's just a process of adding bits of texture here and there, but there's no way I'm going to start doing that eye to the finish. It's not how it works. And I'm just going to zoom out. Oops. And I'm just going to put more darks. I'm just looking at the reference and picking out the darkest areas. But really, in painting, there's no set rule. You do whatever feels right. I think the best part was yesterday, when you go from nothing to something in a relatively short space of time. But this is the process now that starts to slow down, and you have to concentrate more on what you're doing. I was trying to look for a video clip of this actual cheetah sitting on this termite mound, but I think I was too engrossed taking stills, and I didn't have time to shoot video. But I have got a video clip of him just before, in the few moments before the time when he sat on this termite mound, and at some stage or other I will show you that clip. It's only a few seconds, but it was it's quite nice to see. But there's no light. He was in shade, which is a bit of a pain.
And
again, not being critical really about these spots, but just making them a little bit more refined than yesterday. You can always make them up yourself, it really doesn't matter. The only time it would matter is if you were, if you were commissioned, out comes the sun. If you were commissioned by somebody to paint a particular animal that they saw and they wanted to recognise that actual animal, well then you would have to pay far more attention to the markings. A bit like painting someone's pet. If you ask to paint someone's pet dog, which I've been asked to do a few times, obviously the markings on those animals matter a lot. No point painting someone's Alsatian and having it looking like a poodle or something. I don't think they would be very pleased. They are actually quite warm in this lovely evening sunlight. The spots are actually sort of deep orange. And they're certainly not black, so don't at any time start thinking you've got a cheetah with black spots, because they definitely aren't. If you do that, you'll end up with a painting that looks really dull and lifeless. I'm using quite a strong, warm colour. More than you might imagine it should be. But remember, it can always be fine-tuned later on. What you put down doesn't have to be the end result. As I say before, it's a process whereby you build up layers. Spots in the shadow here will be darker, will be a much cooler colour, so I'm using a bit of ultramarine just to darken down. See the difference? I don't know if you can see it. That's the same spot. We've got ultramarine here and cadmium red and orange and burnt umber in the top part. Just flicking in a few little bits of dark as well between the spots, just to start to build up a little bit of texture. And this will be overpainted later with lighter tones, but I just want some suggestion of texture. It's going to do a little bit on the head, which is quite a warm area. I'm getting so engrossed in videoing this, I keep forgetting to take stills photos for the magazine. Again, I'm not interested in painting every spot, every little mark that's on there. It really doesn't matter. It's the general character of the fur that I'm looking at, and all the time monitoring the sunlight. Think sunlight all the time, because this is cadmium yellow and burnt umber. So all these dark areas are actually still very warm and sunny, which is really, really important to remember. You just get a lovely sense of the tufts of fur just catching the light as it sweeps across the face. know if you can see that on the camera. Just give you the impression of sunlight catching the little tufts there. All will be refined later. I will have to say that's my excuse just in case it goes wrong. Just had to stop to take a still photo of it before I carried on. It's had a bit of texture to the mouth. Let's break up that slab of white, warm white that I put on before. Well, good morning. This is day three, and we're going to just carry on refining the main areas of the fur that we were playing around with yesterday. It's all dry again. It wouldn't dry as quick as this, by the way, if you use normal paint. Most of the time I use just normal straightforward oil paint, but if you use Alkyd, Windry Newton Alkyd, dries a lot quicker, which it's just like oil paint, but it dries in a fraction of the time. Well, the pigments aren't quite so strong, but you could use that if you want, or as I'm doing with this demonstration, Liquin makes things dry much, much quicker. But when I work normally, I have about six paintings on the go all at once, so I just rotate them, so the drying isn't an issue for me. Anyway, we have the main composition done. We drew a rough sketch at the start, then blocked it in, which is possibly the most critical stage because you need to have the tones and the colours correct at that stage. And if you don't, you're going to have problems later on because it'll just become dull. And once you started painting detail, it's too late really to start changing it because you'd just be wasting your time and you'll just have to start again. But in the very early stage when you're blocking it in, if it doesn't look right, you've not lost anything, just scrape it off and do it again. So it's really important for that first early stage to be correct tonally and colour, as in the earlier, a few minutes ago, when I showed you the end of the first day, even though it looked blocky, you could see that the sunlight was working. And then from then, it's just a case of refining each stage, really. I mean, we did some refining yesterday, so it got a bit more kind of fur-like texture, and it's still fairly rough, but today I'm just going to refine the fur, the texture of the fur, some more. And really that's the only thing to do, but I'm still watching very carefully the colours that I'm using, bearing in mind we've got warm evening sunlight, and at no time do I want this to start going dull, so I'm going to be watching very carefully the use of white. I might always mix either a little bit of cadmium yellow or cadmium orange with my whites, so it's actually a very pale yellow, which will enhance the effect of sunlight. So with the light air areas, don't use plain white. And the same with the blacks. I hope you're not using black. You can, it makes nice greys and greens, but if you're a beginner, I would stay away from black. And I actually only use about six different colours, sometimes eight, which are the ones I pointed out to you earlier. And I sometimes also use thalassinin green, which is that crazy Windsor green, which is a very strong pigment, and the same with the blue, thalassinin blue, which is also a very crazy, very green blue. There's a lot of green in that. Anyway, so we'll carry on, and we'll hopefully, by the end of this session, we'll have a bit more realism. Off we go. Things are a little different today. I'm using a smaller brush, actually a new size 0 round brush, and it's got far more of an accurate point than the blunt thing I was using before. I don't know if you can see that. Let's go zoom. Can you see that or not? That thicker one is the one I've been using up to now, and this much finer point is the one I'm using today, because we're going to start refining the fur and just getting rid of all that blobbiness that I've been throwing on up to now. Things are going to slow down a bit. It's a bit more tedious, to be honest. So I'm not going to bore you with the whole process, but I'll just show you a little bit of the technique, and really it's the same for the whole thing. So I'm just kind of refining the edges of these spotted areas and adding a few and taking a few away as required, until I just get the rough or rather a fairly accurate feeling of the fur on the top of the head. As again I say all the time, you do not have to copy every little spot. It absolutely doesn't matter, as long as you get the general feel of what you're doing. After all, every cheetah and every lion, tiger, zebra or anything else, no two are exactly the same, so it really doesn't matter. But it does matter that it looks correct. So you just got to look for the subtleties in the fur and just concentrate again all the time on the colour that you're using. This is actually burnt umber with a bit of crimson, I think, just to make sure that it remains nice and warm and sunny. It's looking a bit dull at the moment because I'm putting a fair bit of dark areas on, but when we come back to do the light, the highlights on this, it'll pop into life in a kind of 3D effect. So don't at any stage think you have to arrive at the finished result, because you don't. It's all a case of process, a fine process of layers, really. I'm just adding a little bit of, you aren't still there yet, just adding a little bit of texture, a little bit of cadmium orange. Study the actual texture that you're painting, and even though you know it's fur, you'd actually, most of the time, you won't be painting that. It'll be a very fine texture, which will read as fur when the painting is finished, if that makes sense. I'm using my tickling stick as well this morning for the first time. This pole, which I'm resting my arm on, as we're now starting to have a bit more refinement and detail. What day is it? It's Friday today, just as a matter of interest. Tomorrow is Christmas Eve, so this is my kind of Christmas cheetah. Christmas Eve 2016. So happy Christmas, everybody. That's just cadmium orange, a bit of cadmium yellow mixed with the white. Right, having mixed my sort of neutralised orange, that is orange with a little bit of blue mix, I'm just going to start
little bit of this. This texture to the eye. This is where the whole process slows down, as you can see. Up until now, things have happened fairly quickly, but at this stage and from now on, it can actually become quite tedious, but you have to try to keep the excitement going, knowing what the end result will be. Some lovely little wet highlights right on the nose. Right, I've flipped the canvas on its side just so I can get at this area easier, because my natural brush strokes want to go vertically and I can't go sideways very easily, so I've just flipped the canvas on its side, and I've also flipped the reference on its side and zoomed into this area. So I'm just going to refine a little bit of this fur in the shadow. Now, as it's now in the shadows, our colours are a lot cooler than the darks up here on the top of the head. The dark areas here in sunlight are burnt umber, cadmium orange and cadmium yellow, and the darks in the shadows are ultramarine, burnt umber, and there might be a little bit of orange in there, whatever takes your fancy. And don't get too precious over it. You can always change things later on. Right, I've turned the canvas up on its side so I can do this fur, which is going downwards. Well, it's actually going sideways, but I've flipped it round so that's easier to handle. I've been refining some of the details, but nothing that you haven't seen already. I've just, rather than make this video 10 hours long, I've just turned you off, if you excuse the expression, and just added a little bit of detail here and there. But this is the longer fur just behind the neck, and just going to add a little bit of detail to this. No clever technique really, just little strokes. This is a newer brush. I want it to be reasonably sharp and detailed at this stage. Back to the area under the chin. I move that way. I can give me room to put the video close up so you can see the reference at the same time. just adding little bits of texture, suggesting of, but again, this is the sort of base texture. I will be painting lighter, little flecks of light on top of this, and then you'll get the, hopefully, have the effect of fur in sunlight with kind of highlights and shadows. I'm going to suggest one, two whiskers. If you're painting a cat, don't, for goodness sake, try to paint every single whisker exactly as it is. Unless you're doing some deliberate kind of photorealism, which is not what this is about, but just paint a few whiskers so it looks like there are some whiskers, but in no way does it have to be exactly the same, as I keep saying, same with the spots, same with the whiskers, and same with anything else. Just keep to the general character of what you're painting, without trying to get bogged down with every single little detail. And if you do, you're just going to end up with a complete mess. And you can take this detail to as much depth as you like. You know, I work fairly detailed on the animals, but you know what, if your painting looks nice as at a certain stage and you're happy, stop and go and have a cup of tea and analyse what you've done, and then start another one. There's no rule to say you have to keep going and going and going until you're cross-eyed. I have done most of the main painting now. There's a fair bit of detail. And what I've done is just relax with the picture and just study it and step back from it. And I don't know if you can see, but I'm just going to start refining even more some of the detail. I don't feel there's enough definition in some of the markings on the cheetah. I'm just going to refine some of the dark, so then add a bit more light and just bring up the lights in the white fur a little bit more, just to punch it out. We're fairly close to the finish, and the last stages are usually the time when it sort of pops into life. I'm happy with the way it's gone, but as I say, I'm going to just refine some detail. It's going to take a little while, so I'm not going to show you the whole process because you'll fall asleep. So I'm just going to show a little bit of maybe the top of the head and the fur in the shadow on the right. And I'm also going to redefine the shadow at the base, plus the background. I haven't done that yet, so we'll do that towards the end. So that's that. Let's crack on. Right. For these darks, there's a bit of burnt umber, ultramarine, cadmium red is already there, a bit of cadmium yellow, and a little bit of cadmium orange won't go amiss.
I'm also going to use Crummy Old Crimson just to get some rich darks. And Titanium White. And a blob. Oops, that's too much. You're doing fine detail today, so I won't need all that. This is like a gel, this liquid, and it doesn't flow like a liquid. It sort of sits where you put it, so you can just, you don't really need to put it in a container, you can just put a blob on your palette and it'll be fine. I'm using very fine, as you can see that, number zero round Aquafine, but any sable type brush will do for this. And there you go. I'm just going to mix a bit of liquid and just pre-mix some dark with a bit of cadmium orange, just to mix in if I want. Ultramarine, just a gooey, it's not critical really, as long as it's a dark colour, dark tone, that's really all I need. A little bit of cadmium yellow on standby. Right, I'm just going to refine just some of the shapes of these dark spots. As I said before, you don't have to copy every little spot and whisker exactly, but I just feel then the head, the top of the head here isn't quite defined well enough, so I'm just very gently going to put these darker specks in here and there, just as and when I feel like it really. Christmas has come and gone, by the way. It's now mid-week between Christmas and New Year. I know you could be watching this video in the summer, so it's not really relevant, but just gives me something to talk about while I'm doing this. Need to be, just be patient and take your time. Don't rush this part, because this really is the time when the painting should snap into life, and all the work we did earlier with all the wild bold colours, that's now the sort of the base that we're painting on top of. So this part needs to be quite carefully done and refined. This is burnt umber and ultramarine for the darks, dark areas in shadow, whereas the light areas are cadmium orange and cadmium yellow and burnt umber. Even though they're dark, they're still kind of warm darks. Whereas down here in the shadows it can be a lot bluer. But it won't look blue when you look at it from a distance. It will just look like dark, it'll just look like black spots really. Mixing a little bit of warm light orangey ochre colour for the lighter areas on the head. Doing tiny little catch lights, tiny little thick tufts, just to emphasise the light catching the fur. And I've obviously flipped the reference and the canvas upside down, just so my brush strokes are easier. I'm using fairly thick paint
quite thick paint, as it needs to be opaque. And it's neat too. I'm not using any liquid with this. I'm just using paint straight from the tube. And if you think your painting is looking fine and you're nervous about going any further with it, that's great. Just tidy it up as and when it wherever it needs it, and just leave it at that. I do tend to go quite detailed in my wildlife, but you don't have to. If you feel happy with the stage you've reached, that's great. Just leave it at that and do another one. But monitor your painting all the time, far more than the reference. We're not trying to do an exact copy of any photograph. The painting should be unique, and it just needs to look right independently of any photographic reference. And I'm just going to do a little bit of the background. Let's get a bit of orange. This is thalassinin green, cadmium yellow light, cadmium yellow, and a little bit of cadmium orange. And I'm just going to play around with these on the palette for a second. I just want a sort of warm, I don't know, yellowy green, which I'm just going to put just behind that cold shadow on the right hand side that I was talking about earlier. And I want some contrast between the cold shadow on the cheetah and the background right behind him is warm sunlight. I can see straight away that's far too dull. I'm just going to go back to my paint, just lighten it up a bit, and I'm just dragging, letting the brush drag under its own weight. No real pressure. And what I'm interested in is just the contrast between sunlight in the background and the shadow in the foreground. And I'm not actually really painting any twigs or leaves or anything. It's just suggestion. So don't worry about painting branches of trees and leaves and things like that. It really doesn't matter. And don't overwork it, otherwise it'll become a mess and take attention away from the cheetah's face. And this actually, can you see that on there? This is the background colour still showing through. You can still even see part of my grid under there. And if there's nice reds and oranges, it's a good idea to add a few of the same colours. Just dipping into my orange and just pop a little bit in the background, so to kind of unify the whole painting. You don't want orange cat, green background. The two need to kind of work together, so it looks more convincing. I'm going to hardly do anything to this background because it really doesn't need it. If it was a larger painting, it would definitely need more attention than I'm putting on. But just for this little cheetah demonstration, it doesn't need very much at all. I'm also using my rigger. I'm just going to dip my paint into the rigger, which is a very fine brush. It's about an inch. The bristles are about an inch long, and you can just pop in a few very simple suggestions of grass. Just letting the brush fall onto the canvas under its own weight. We're not handwriting. I'm not doing any definite detail. Just hold the brush loose and just let it fall under its own weight. Using thick paint. There's really thick there. And it'll give the impression of blades of grass just catching the sunlight. We've just about finished the painting. Just to do a quick recap, it's just basic
ordinary stretch canvas that I've covered with a kind of brown ochre-y colour. It doesn't really matter whether you do that or not, it's up to you, but I think it helps when you're adding highlights. It kind of you can tell better whether the lights are working. So we did the first drawing in thin paint using it's actually a very blunt brush, that, but any sort of small brush will do when we're doing the initial drawing. Just block in basic colours, warms and cools in very, very, very simple slabs of colour, and try to get a bit of variety. Don't just use one colour, otherwise it's just going to look pretty bland. So look for subtleties in the reference, whether it's this cheetah or any other animal you're painting, just look for subtle differences in the colour, and especially reflected light, the colour of the reflected light, whether there's blue reflecting from the sky or warm light reflecting from the ground. Try to look for all those as well. And then after that, when it's dry or partly dry, it's just a case of starting to add texture and detail in various places, and you just have to go over the whole painting, but don't at any time try to finish any area all at once. All these light areas are actually very pale orange, yellow orange, and that helps create the illusion of warm sunlight. Hope you've enjoyed the process, and I dare say I will be doing some other tutorials in the future. So if you've made it this far, thank you very much for watching, and enjoy your art. Goodbye. Malaika, nakupenda malaika. Malaika.